The Desert Fathers. Hopefully you read the introduction, but if you didn't, I'm going to go through the introduction to this, and then what I'm going to try to do today is we're going to go through about the first half. Obviously, we're not going to comment on every saying that's in the first half. And by the first half, I mean about the first... That's right, I was going to do that next time. The first 88 pages. And I've got maybe, in some of the sections, just one or two items I want to discuss. And then next week, next Tuesday, we'll finish going over the last of the items in here. So, what you have here is a collection of sayings, and notice how these are arranged. I mean, they're arranged according to theme or topic. So, if you look at the table of contents, it begins with progress and perfection, and then you have listed essentially a bunch of virtues, with one exception, lust. Lust obviously isn't a virtue, okay? But they're dealing with lust from a virtuous standpoint, that is, how to overcome the demon or the passion of lust. So the virtues, quiet, compunction, self-control, lust, possessing nothing, fortitude, nothing done for show, non-judgment, discretion, sober living. Sober here doesn't mean undrunk. Okay, it means sober, serious living, solemn living. Unceasing prayer, hospitality, obedience, patience, humility, patience, charity, and then visions. This is based upon, that is this translation, Benedict of, this is Helen Waddell, right? Which one is this? This is Benedict Award. Yeah, this is Benedict Award. Her edition here is based upon what's called the systematic sayings of the fathers. There were two major collections begun probably sometime in the 6th century. Okay, there was the systematic sayings of the Desert Fathers, and there were the alphabetical sayings. Okay. And the alphabetical sayings, and I really wrestled as to which version to use. The alphabetical sayings are alphabetical by author or the name of the Desert Father. So it begins with, trying to remember, Ammon, I think it is, A-M-M-O-N. And then you have Antony and Arsenius, one or two others, and then you go to the next letter in the Greek alphabet, beta, and you get Barsanuphius and Bessarion and a few others, and then there are several anonymous ones. If I remember correctly, the anonymous ones come at the end with no name attached to them. In the alphabetical sayings, and I don't think this is true for this one, in the alphabetical sayings, one Desert Father stands out above all the others in terms of frequency, and that's Saint Antony, or Anthony, okay? He's got the most sayings of anybody else. I think after him comes Poemen, P-O-E-M-E-N, and then it gradually gets smaller and smaller until you get to the anonymous ones, and then the anonymous ones, there's just quite a few. Probably one of the reasons that Anthony has the greatest number is because he's generally called the father of monasticism. Okay? He begins the monastic movement in the Christian church. Now, prior to Anthony, there were quote-unquote monks. Because a monk was essentially just someone who went off and lived in the desert away from people. Okay? For reasons of purifying the self. I mean, you've got a great example of what is essentially a monk in the opening pages of the New Testament. John the Baptist, who lived in the desert. What did he eat? Locusts and honey. Okay. Christ goes off in the desert for 40 days and 40 nights. That is essentially kind of a monastic endeavor. But let's back up to the introduction. The very first page, Benedict Award writes, "Detachment from selfish concerns was always of the essence for Christianity. The invitation of Jesus to the young ruler, go, sell all that you have, and come and follow me, provided a central theme for Christians in the first three centuries." Okay? It was, in fact, those very words that Anthony heard one Sunday that caused him to literally go sell all that you have. Okay? He gone into church. Actually, he was passing by a church, and he heard the deacon or priest proclaiming those words. Go sell all that you have, come and follow me. And his parents had died recently, and he went, sold all that he had, left some of the money aside to care for his sister, okay, put her essentially into a monastery for women, to care for her, food and water, clothes, lodging, all that kind of stuff. And he went and he lived on the outskirts of town for a while. And then it entered his mind, he had sought out advice from a quote-unquote holy elder. And the elder said, go off into the desert. And he does. He goes, I mean, way off into the desert. At first he lives among the tombs, okay, kind of as a way to get into his mindset. I thought I had that shut off. As a way to get into his mindset, you know, life here is fleeting. Okay, this isn't the final resting place. This isn't the real home. And then later on, he goes and moves into a cave, and he walls up the entrance of the cave, and people come and bring him food and water sporadically. And he lives that way, I think it is, for 20 years. Okay, we'll talk about that a little bit later. So she goes on. This idea of detachment was seen as the most direct way of discipleship. The surest way to learn what it meant to be with Jesus before the face of the Father. This sense of detachment from this world had also an eschatological dimension, that is, an end of the world dimension. The phrase, Maranatha, even so come, Lord Jesus, last words of the New Testament, okay, was not a vague hope, but an immediate and joyful expectation. I mean, we're told in the Gospels, what did the disciples expect? The end was coming soon. I mean, we hear them ask Jesus, tell us, when are you coming again? And he says, I'm not going to tell you. I want you to what? To be standing ready, to be alert. Okay? So she says, and she quotes, I don't know where this quote is from. Quotes from the Didache. Let grace come and this world pass away, Christians said in their corporate prayer at the Eucharist. Okay, now she says that's from the Didache. Keep in mind, when was the Didache composed? Sometime between about 90 and 150. So that's pretty soon after the crucifixion and such. Okay. Skip on down to after the little break in the page, and she writes, the world renouncing perspective of waiting for the coming of the Lord was maintained even under threat of death and found expression especially in the accounts of those who died rather than compromise, such as the passions of Perpetua and Felicity, okay, and some of the, you know, the martyrdom of Polycarp, the martyrdom of Saint Ignatius, and lots of other martyrdoms that we didn't discuss or read. I mean, there are scores of them that you can read about. Now, The martyrdom is what's happening within the first 3 to 4 centuries. Okay? Once Constantine takes the imperial throne, passes the Edict of Milan, which says Christianity is no longer outlawed, okay, and then later on makes Christianity, actually this is after Constantine, in 381 or 380, when Christianity becomes the official, okay, religion of the empire, you don't have martyrdom. So if in those first 3 centuries, martyrdom is the way to show you're really a Christian, and martyrdom is the way to show that you really are detaching from this world and seeking heaven, the better world, what do you do when martyrdom is no longer an option? Yeah. Yeah. You die to self. Okay? You die to the world. You know, there's a reason why priests, Catholic, Orthodox, even Jewish, you know, rabbis and stuff, there's a reason why they wear black. Black signifies death to the world. Black signifies, yeah, they might be walking around, their bodies might be animated, but up here, especially for Orthodox and Catholic priests, for those who are thinking about it, up here, they're already, as it were, dead. The world holds nothing for them. Okay? So she writes on page 9, gradually a need for a more absolute retirement for this way of life caused people to seek places of solitude. What better place of solitude, okay, for Christians in the Middle East, because keep in mind that's where Christianity grew and flourished, what better places of solitude than to go off in the desert? Okay. If you were in Palestine, to go off in the desert essentially meant east of the Jordan River, okay, or south to the Negev Desert or the Sinai Peninsula. Okay. If you were in Egypt, it was to go south, outside of what is today Alexandria and Cairo, down the Nile and then either east or west from the Nile. And you can still go today to the monastery founded by St. Anthony the Great. It is still in operation. Okay? Now, the whole quote-unquote Arab Spring has not been, how do I put this, very beneficial or kind for the Christian communities in Egypt, in Palestine, in Syria. Okay, I've got friends who have family who are still in Egypt. When all the unrest occurred in Egypt 2 years ago, a lot of churches, well over 80, were burned and destroyed. Some of those churches, one of them, St. Mark's, and I'm trying to remember where, and I can't remember where, dated back to the 7th century. And it was destroyed. Okay. There's a town in Syria called Maloula. M-A-L-O-U-L-A. That has a monastery and a convent. Has a monastery for nuns. But in Maloula, okay, Aramaic is the common, ordinary language. Aramaic's the language that was spoken by Christ. Okay, this monastery had quote-unquote relics and artifacts going back to the 5th and 6th centuries. Well, some of the, according to several U.S. senators, freedom-loving, God-fearing Syrian rebels, you know, looted that church, kidnapped the abbess of the monastery and 11 of her nuns. They were recently released. They were released in January. You know, and it pretty much decimated the town. Okay, Now, again, these are communities of Christians that date back. Again, some of them, the town of Mooloolah goes back to like 500 or 1,000 BC. I mean, it's been continuously inhabited for that long, right? So, you know, the Arab Spring has not been a very beneficial thing for these areas where these monasteries were set up and are often still running. So she says, with the end of persecution at the beginning of the 4th century, under Constantine, began to turn world-forsaking Christians into respectable citizens. Because Christians had been condemned, now they were accepted. Okay, so what does that mean, they were accepted? Once Christianity became legal, what did that also mean for Christians? Okay, they obviously weren't persecuted anymore, but what else? Okay, keep going with that, though. You know, what was one of the things said by some far-right wackos when President Obama ran for election, 2008? Okay, other than that, yeah, he wasn't a citizen. He was Muslim. He wasn't a Christian. Okay? Same thing, essentially, was said in 1960 when JFK ran for president. Why? Because he was Catholic. And every good American Protestant, white, Anglo-Saxon Protestant, knows if you're Catholic, you're not a Christian. Okay? This was kind of the mentality among especially Southern Baptists. Okay? Or a lot of Baptists. Okay? As if our Constitution had any kind of religious requirement, right? Because it doesn't. In fact, it's specifically
deist.
Yeah. So one of the things that happened when Christianity became the legal religion was it immediately became fashionable to be Christian. Okay? Prior to that, it was dangerous to be a Christian. So you didn't have people signing up. You didn't have people going out to the public squares and saying, you know, loudly and vociferously, I am a Christian. I mean, you did have some people, like St. Ignatius, who wouldn't shut up about it. Okay? That is, who willingly took on martyrdom. But it again, even those folks, it wasn't commonly accepted by the rest of the people. Once Christianity becomes public, becomes official, you have all kinds of people becoming Christian. The question then becomes, what kind of Christian are they becoming? Because everybody knows this, you can see people who become Christian in name only. And then there are others who become Christian like these fathers do, fathers and mothers. I don't know if you notice, you know, you have several instances of Synclectica speaking. She was a mother. Not that she had children, she was an abbess, essentially. What we would call as you have spiritual fathers, you have spiritual mothers. There was Sarah, who was also. And then there was one other one that's named, whose name's escaping me. So, where do they go? She tells us, the deserts of Syria, Palestine, and above all, Egypt. Here, earnest and devoted Christians were, apart from the immediate demands of society, family, and church, notice. Okay? So they didn't have demands put on them by the world, taxes, as an example. Okay? They didn't have demands put on them by family. You need to come bury your father. What does Jesus say when one of the disciples says, I need to go bury my father?
Let the dead
bury their dead and come and follow me. Okay? Demands of the church. Well, what are the demands of the church? Attendance? Tithing? Yeah. Working for the church? Even the duties of care for the poor, the sick, and the needy were at a remove from their daily life. Okay, now keep in mind, the demands of the poor, the sick, and the needy are central to everything Christ says. So how do these monks go off into the desert and not care for the poor, the sick, or the needy?
Oh, sorry, backing up just a little bit. When did it become law that Christians had to attend church? Was that after the
spring? That's later.
Was that after the or was that ever an Orthodox? I mean, not Orthodox. Was that ever a Roman law?
I don't think that's a... No, I don't think that was... That wasn't in the early church at all. I'm pretty sure that's a medieval creation.
Anyway, carry on.
No, it's...
Well, it does talk about in Hebrews how you're supposed to come together as the...
Body. Yeah, you are supposed to come together, but it...
But not like legally.
Yeah, Hebrews isn't a legal injunction. And I'm almost positive that we don't see that kind of secular injunction to do that. Same thing. I don't think, I could be wrong here, but I don't think the empire, at least in the first 7 or 8 centuries, and by that I mean up to 700 or 800, I don't think the empire mandated you had to pay your tithe. I honestly think that's more of a Western invention. I mean, and that is definitely in place. By 1100, okay, where if you don't pay your tithe, the archdeacon can come get you and haul you off and throw you into quote-unquote ecclesiastical jail, which would turn out to be the secular jail, okay, but until you paid up, yeah, you were incarcerated in many places.
So, right. Go ahead. Another question relating to that. When the Christianity religion, did that mean that everyone was required to be a Christian at that time?
No.
No, that was just later on that they...
Yeah, and again, even in the Eastern Empire, I don't think it ever actually became a requirement. Well, no, it's not necessarily a Protestant thing. Where you see that idea, I think most forcefully employed is with someone like Charlemagne. Charlemagne, 800 AD, what does he do? You are converted at the tip of the sword. You either convert or die. But what is part of the impetus of that mentality? That is, that doesn't arise naturally within Christianity. Part of it's about spreading the empire. Part of it arises because of what's going on at about the same time. The rise of Islam. And Islam does teach forced conversions, period. I mean, it's in the Quran. Okay? Christianity does not have, in the New Testament, anything about forced conversions. Yeah, you've got all kinds of stuff in the early pages of the Old Testament. Okay? But even there, it's not about conversion. When Joshua is told to take the city of Ai, for example, it's not about converting the inhabitants of the city of Ai. It's about killing all of them. And it's when they don't kill all of them that then what happens? Problems arise. Okay? So when they don't follow the word, you know, when God commands them to do something, situations arise. So that, you know, later period we're talking about, you know, when Islam begins and it spreads like fire, okay, when it starts to spread throughout Saudi Arabia, what today we call Saudi Arabia or what was then just called Arabia, Arabia was largely Christian when Muhammad was born. Okay? And it spreads. It's not necessarily a matter of Islam converting willing people, okay, in the early years. I mean, that's why it was an army that went out and, you know, is conquering one place after another. You know, and this is part of the problem, let's jump up to today, this is part of the problem with militant Islam. Because What is one of the ideas inherent in modern-day militant Islam? The idea is, let's regain the territory that was lost. Well, what is that territory? It goes all the way up to Tours, France. Okay, so it's pretty much half of modern-day France. Okay, they've already got, you know, Turkey, etc., but it would spread up into Greece. Okay, it'd be all of northern Africa, which it already is, and it would spread all the way over into India. Well, there's already great tension in India today between two main religious groups, Muslims and Hindus. And they're about to elect a new nationalist Hindu prime minister or president. And the Muslims are not very happy about that because in the past, when the Hindus have been in control, there have been some pogroms against Muslims as, you know, when the tables are turned, it works the other way, okay?
We're talking about the Desert Fathers not helping the poor and going out.
Right. But they do help the poor, as we will see when we read their stuff, because what are they often doing? As they're sitting there praying, and I mean literally sitting, praying, they're weaving baskets. They make baskets out of reeds. That's pretty much what they quote-unquote do. They then sell those baskets. They take the proceeds from the selling of the baskets. They keep a little for themselves for their own needs. And they distribute the rest. It's not where they keep 90% and give 10%. It's more like they keep 10%. And give away 90%. And there's all kinds of stories in here. And again, we're not going to hit all of them by any means. But there's all kinds of stories in here of, you know, once the fame of the Desert Fathers spreads, and people are in what today we call Europe, and they're hearing about Anthony the Great. And so you start to see a trail of visitors, you know, kind of like if you build it, they will come. Well, if they hear about these saints, people start to want to come. And what do? They bring gifts. They bring wealth. And in almost every instance where we read about that, we hear a desert father saying, I don't want it. Because what use is wealth for them? It's like a brick tied to them. It draws them back down out of the heavens and ties them to earth. It's just an anchor when they don't need an anchor. Okay? So she goes on a couple of sentences after that. Instead of dealing with the manifestations of evil in daily life, they were what? Concerned with the source of sin where? Here. See, because those other needs of society, family, and the church, those are concerned with the manifestations and the alleviation of evil in daily life. I mean, there is, you know, a very good reason why in the book of Acts we're told the apostles get together and they choose seven from among them to be deacons. What's the purpose of the deacons? To care for the needy, the poor, the hungry, the widows. Okay? It's their job to distribute the goods. Okay? While the apostles can pray and teach. So, they're concerned with the source of sin in the human heart. In here. Because there wouldn't be any sin out there if it was removed in here. And what do they become, she says? They become intercessors for all humanity. Just as, okay, Athanasius and Basil and Maximus write that Christ becomes the intercessor for all because he takes on humanity. He becomes human flesh, and his death is death for all. Similarly, the monks, okay, or the Desert Fathers become intercessors for all. That is, as they reach ever greater states of purification, what are they, one, showing? It's possible. Okay. But two, They're not reaching those ever greater and greater states of purification solely for themselves. Because what are they doing throughout their lives? They are praying for the whole world. They're not just praying, Lord God, cleanse me and only me, a sinner, but let Caroline go to hell. It's not what they're interested in. Okay? So, the early Christian ideal of standing where Christ stands was gradually combined with a much older and essentially dualist way of life. That is, the way of the monk, the one who lived not in company with another, but alone before God. And so she talks about how then we get the desert fathers. Why are they called fathers? Another word that's used is elders, or old men and old women. Okay, but it's not old in age, because some of the desert fathers were young when they began.
Wise.
Yeah, it's wise. One of the versions of the sayings of the desert fathers is a book called the Gerontocon. Like we have today gerontologists and gerontology, which is the study or the medical field of dealing with elderly people. Okay. The Gerontocon, the icon of the old folks, okay, was a book of the elders. Okay. All it means is essentially like you have, wow, this is a, here's a metaphysical conceit, like you have in the Old Norse book, the Poetic Edda, there is a section called the Sayings of the Wise One. Okay? That's what these are. These are the sayings that they've passed on. We're going to talk in a couple of minutes about how these sayings get passed on and how they're meant to be read. So, page 10. These men and women lived alone as hermits or with disciples living by or later on in groups in monasteries. Okay. And what she's just given you without stating it is the progression. They began as hermits, solitary. Okay? Then, after a while, they began to live in groups. Not necessarily, you know, where they would have a house or something and live together, but, you know, where you'd have maybe, let's say, an area where there's a bunch of caves, and one hermit would be in one cave, and maybe 30 feet away there'd be another hermit there, okay? And around like that. Later, you actually get what we today would call monasteries built, okay? Where each individual would have their own cell. And the cell was usually fairly small, 6 by 10 feet, something like that. Okay, because they wouldn't have furniture. They'd sleep on the floor. They wouldn't have a desk. They wouldn't have a chair. They wouldn't have a bench. They wouldn't have a mattress. Okay? If they had anything to sleep on, it would, one, be their cloak or maybe some palm branches or rushes or reeds, straw kind of a thing. Okay? But they would work together communally. That is, they would have their own private rules of prayer, but then they would also come together communally for prayer. They would come together communally for meals, and they would come together communally for work. That is, you might have three or four brothers who would go off and do one task, another few go do another task, another do another task. That develops up to today's monastery, where you have, you know, people in charge of the kitchen, people in charge of greeting visitors, because monasteries today are great tourist places. Okay? You'd have people making bread. You'd have people, if you're a Trappist monastery in Belgium, for example, making good Trappist beer. Okay, a lot of monasteries, you know, produce stuff like honey, wax for candles, or they make candles, or they make incense, or they make, you know, a variety of other things like that. Most of the first Christian monks were neither clerics nor scholars. Okay, we kind of think, you know, someone like Antony the Great, oh man, this guy had to be a great priest. No. Or he had to be a great intellectual. No. Because one thing the early Cheech. The early Cheech churches, the early church teaches, is that intellect can get in the way. Okay? We don't see it as much in here. You see it a little bit in the section on self-control. And I think it's going to be in discretion and sober living. This idea that, you know, it's our thoughts that plague us. It's definitely in the section on lust. Okay? Thoughts of lust, thoughts of fornication trouble these guys. Well, just as those do, other kinds of thoughts, knowledge per se, knowledge of, you know, for these writers or talkers, writers of, you know, for example, Greek and Roman classics, all of that knowledge can become what? Burdensome. Because it can lead you to overthink things. How many of you have ever read any of Samuel Johnson's stuff? Have you had an 18th century? Rasselas, or the Prince of Abyssinia. There's an old guy in that story, and what torments him? His mind. Because he just sits there and thinks and thinks and thinks and thinks, and he can never achieve what in here, in the section on quiet, they're going to call quiet. Stillness. Peace. All right? So what do they do when they go off and live by themselves? A lifestyle of great simplicity. They meditate on much of the Bible as they knew by heart, especially the Psalms. Some of them knew the Bible by heart. Genesis to Revelation. Okay? Because they didn't have copies of it with them. And we're going to read in a passage why some of them didn't have Bibles with them. Okay? Having a copy of the Bible was a very expensive object. In order to get that copy of the Bible, what did they have to have? Money. To have that copy of the Bible made. What could that money be better used for?
The poor.
The poor. I mean, there's a passage in here we're going to read. You know, a monk comes into another monk's cell and says, you know, think of all the widows and orphans.
But you could buy a Bible and give it to the poor.
Because the guy had a bunch of books on his windowsill.
The Bible's not going to buy you food.
Yeah. An early 20th century, early 20th century Russian writer, Nicholas Berdyaev, said famously, bread for myself is material matter. Bread for my neighbor is a spiritual matter. But what did he mean by that?
Giving.
Yeah. If I'm hungry, that's a matter of my body. If my neighbor is hungry, and the implication is, and I do nothing, then that's a spiritual issue. Not for him, for me. It's also a spiritual issue if I then feed that person, okay? And this guy, if I remember correctly, Berdyaev was not a Christian. He was just a quote-unquote kind of a, you know, noble secularist. So, they meditate on the Bible, especially the Psalms. What else? She emphasizes, you know, this idea, and we're going to see this again in the sayings, the necessity to stay put, to St. Augustine calls it, says, to do what you're doing, period. Okay? She says, quoting one of them, go and sit in your cell, and your cell will teach you everything. Okay? What does that mean? Go and sit in your cell. That's go sit in your room, and you're sitting there alone, you will learn everything. Here's an example of what it means. There's a, I think he's still alive, I'm not positive. There's a Romanian priest named Father Roman Braga, 20th century, I think he's still alive, who is now at a monastery in Michigan. He's at a women's monastery. He's the priest for the women there. If he is still alive, he's got to be close to 100. He was imprisoned by the Soviets in Romania because he was a priest. He was well-respected, well-thought of, great intellectual, all that kind of stuff. And I once heard a talk by him. This was, I don't know, 15 years ago or so. And he said he never really knew, okay, let's say experientially. He never really knew what his faith meant. That is, how it was important, how it informed his life, what it led to, all that kind of stuff. Until the communists put him in solitary confinement for 10 years. And he said it was being in solitary confinement for 10 years that he finally understood what Christianity was all about. Okay, he'd been a priest for like 30 years prior to this. That means, you know, every Sunday he's serving the holy mysteries, he's hearing confession, he's absolving sins, he's there at baptism, the whole nine yards. And he says, and this is why, it was only as a result of the 10 years of solitary confinement, I think it was 10 years, that he says he understood what Christ meant when Christ said, seek first the kingdom of God. Where is it? Inside. Okay? Because he didn't have anything externally to go on. He had no contact with people other than his captors shoving food and water through the door once a day. He had no reading material. So what did he do? He just meditated and contemplated on what he already knew, had memorized, of scripture, of prayers, of, you know, church services, etc. And what did that do? It got him to not look upon the world around outside, which in his case was a small cell, but it got him to turn inwards. Okay? Go and sit in your cell, and your cell will teach you everything. Sometimes a newcomer would live near a more experienced monk, or three or four. Okay? How would they learn? By example. Okay. You're going to see quite a bit in here. Somebody goes up to a monk and they say, Father, give me a word. Well, it seems like 9 times out of 10, the father will say, no, I'm not going to. And then the 1 times out of 10, they'll say something. Now, what the inquirer is doing is they're not saying, come, give me a thesis. Give me a point. Okay? They're saying, give me a bit of your wisdom. And they don't sit there and they write that down and then they say, now give me another one. And give me another one. Because what we see, and we don't see this as clearly in here as you do maybe in the much fuller book called The Book of the Elders, which is very similar to this. Where what they do is, you know, somebody would go to Anthony the Great and say, you know, Father Anthony, give me a word. And Anthony would give him a little short pithy saying. What the inquirer then does is they go away. And they contemplate on that little short pithy saying. And they don't come back for a quote unquote another word until they have internalized the first word. That is, until that first word the father or mother gave, has become part of their very being and they understand it in here, not up here. Okay? So, I'm going to skip a bunch again. First, skip a bunch. She talks about page 11, Roman numeral 11. The fathers saw themselves as poor men, sinners in need of mercy, blah, 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 blah. But a visitor wrote, these are they by whom the world is kept in being. Now, I don't remember if we talked about this in Maximus the Confessor, but Maximus talks about how the very fact that the world still exists, okay, let's say when he's writing, 700 AD, the very fact that it still exists is because of one thing. Prayers of holy people imploring God to allow it to continue existing. Why? So that all men may be saved. In other words, don't bring your judgment now. Why? Because there are still people lost. Okay? Don't bring your judgment. Don't bring the second coming until all men may be saved. Why? Because St. Paul says, and Christ says, the Father desires what? That all men may be saved. Okay? Top of the next page, she writes that, you know, what do they do? Their idea, their goal is prayer without ceasing. That is, they're sitting there making their palms, they're eating, they're talking sporadically. And the idea is that they would develop this prayer habit so that even when they are intellectually occupied with something, their heart is still praying. Okay? And then she goes on and talks about how, you know, the natural world gets transformed by them. You know, they talk to animals. I don't know if that means the animals talk back and they understand. Okay. They have, you know, mystical experiences, you know, as we saw in the life of St. Mary of Egypt. You know, Zosimus looks up and Mary's praying and she's hovering 3 feet off the ground. Okay. What does our modern Western mindset say when we read something like that? Or maybe it doesn't for you. It does for me. Get out of here. People don't hover off the ground. People don't talk to hyenas and quote unquote, right in the middle of Roman numeral 11, extract a promise from a mother hyena not to kill sheep any longer. You promise you won't kill Farmer McDonald's sheep. And she says, I promise. That's what? That's the stuff of fairy tales, right? Okay. According to these writers or these speakers, that's not fairy tale. The lion shall lie down with the lamb isn't fairy tale. What is it? It's a restoration of Eden. And that's what they're about, restoring Eden, bringing Eden, in a sense, back. It's the restoration of what life was supposed to be. All that stuff that Athanasius and Maximus talk about, and Basil, about the grace at the beginning, and being made in the likeness of God. Okay, being made in the likeness of God, if Adam had continued, would have meant not only naming the creatures, but then some of the fathers say, talking with them. Okay? You know, why is it we have special relationships with pets? Because that's a little sliver of an inkling of what life was supposed to be like. But pets weren't supposed to be our, you know, playthings per se. They were sharers of fullness. Or grace, let's say. Roman numeral 13. I've got to skip a lot because we're running out of time. If there was failure or weakness in anyone, it was at once understood that this was not what that person really desired. And therefore, the weak were not blamed, but encouraged to start again. I don't think it's in here, because I'm not positive, but I don't think this is a complete translation of everything in the Systematic Saints. But in one saying, a monk comes to Anthony and says, you know, Abba Anthony, I keep sinning. What shall I do? And Anthony says, when you fall, get up. And when you fall again, get up. And when you fall again, get up. And what he's saying there is it's the getting up that's the important thing. He never says, oh, well, you'll never fall again. He just says, you have to get up. Because what does it mean if you don't get up? You give up. And if you give up, then whatever that sin is, that takes control. So he says, when you sin, confess and get up. Confess and get up. And there's going to be a saying that we're going to talk about where somebody comes to another priest and talks about, you know, this kind of thing. Just after that passage I read, when some monks plan to discipline a brother who is guilty of sin, they were reminded of this basic rule of non-judgment, which I'm not going to talk about this passage right now. We'll look at it later. They don't judge one another at all. In fact, you'll see many of the fathers, one of them, Moses, called Moses the Black because he was Ethiopian, who had been a robber and murderer before he became a Christian monk. You know, it's a group of monks come to him and say, we caught our brother doing X, Y, or Z. Okay, I don't remember what the sin was. And Moses essentially says, the sin you're committing now by telling me is even worse than the sin your brother was committing. Because what are they doing? They're judging. Okay. We're going to see a saying here where essentially one of the monks is going to say, don't judge. Why? Because God hasn't judged that person yet. You know, drove me up a wall angry. You cannot imagine how angry I was. The day when it was announced that Osama bin Laden had been killed, Mike Huckabee, former governor of Arkansas, Baptist pastor, said, anybody remember what he said?
Like good or something like
that. Other than that, more than that, I should say, he said something about he will rot in hell. And he said it with glee in his voice and joy on his face. Okay. Yeah, sorry, I thought it was closed.
I know a lot of Christians that were like, good, I'm glad you said. I'm like, how could you say that? I don't think that's part of the Christian movement. I think that's part of the whole country.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's what it was. I mean,
I was
disgusted by the parties and celebration. Because one of the things that you'll maybe come away from reading these is, we celebrate no person's death. None. Okay? And they'll kind of explain why. Okay, I'm going to skip a bunch again.
Even the death of believers, just to clarify.
Pardon that again?
Even the death of believers, just
to clarify. To celebrate? No, you can celebrate that because there is a assumption, let's say, on the part of, let me rephrase, you never celebrate someone's death and assume that they're going to hell. Okay? It's God's job to determine where people go. It's not ours. Yes, Caroline.
What about Judas? I know, like, a lot of people, they just assume that he's gone.
What does the scripture say about Judas? Well,
so guilty that
he repented of betraying Jesus, but then what did he do? He hung himself. Okay.
That's a mortal sin.
And that's a mortal sin. Or, you know, you can't repent.
When you kill yourself?
Yeah. That's what the church has historically taught. You can't. Now, I know some, and there are bishops and such, and there are fathers in the Orthodox Church. I don't know of any in the Catholic Church that say this, but there are fathers and bishops and such in the Orthodox Church that will say anyone who commits suicide is mentally ill. And if they are mentally ill, then they are not held accountable for that sin because they're not themselves. And they say they're mentally ill because what is one of the greatest ingrained instincts that we have? Self-preservation. And so if someone is so full of despair that they kill themselves, it's either mental illness or possession. It's demonic. It's they don't have control. Okay. But I mean, that's why the Catholic Church didn't used to, I don't know, it probably does today, or some churches I'm sure do, would not bury a suicide within hallowed ground. Suicides would be buried outside the churchyard. Okay. As a nice little reminder. Shakespeare deals with this, by the way, in Hamlet. Very, you know, judiciously, because Ophelia gets buried within the church ground. And you even have the clowns going, what'd she get buried in the church ground for, you know? She killed herself. Yeah, well, you know, the priest says, nope, it's okay. Who are we to argue? Hamlet, by the way, is one of Shakespeare's plays where you see this huge tension between Catholic and Protestant thought. Okay? A lot of people think it's Shakespeare kind of wrestling with himself, as it were. And then she goes on, and the rest of the introduction kind of talks about the emphasis, or the, not the emphasis, the influence, you know, these writings have on later spirituality, specifically later medieval and English spirituality. Because this thing gets translated, and then you have all kinds of writers referring back to these sayings. Okay, English writers, Abelard and Heloise, possibly, I think the writer of Sir Gawain and the Green Knight may have been familiar with some of these. Definitely Renaissance writers like John Donne. Okay. Turn to the note on the text real briefly. She mentions, you know, these kinds of sayings, or the sayings of the fathers, she says, consisted of five different kinds of literature. Accounts of individuals. I had it on the syllabus, but we had to drop it. You know, Lives of the Desert Fathers, for example. The Life of St. Anthony the Great, written by Athanasius. The Rule of St. Pachomius. The Rule of St. Basil. The Rule of St. Benedict, etc. Okay? What else? Well, I mean, St. Mary of Egypt. Second, so lives of individuals. Second, travel journals. And there's one real famous one. She mentions a couple. There's one real famous one by a woman, a Spanish woman named Egeria. She's a saint, which is very important for study of this kind of period because she goes to Jerusalem at Easter. And I think the exact year is mentioned. I don't remember what it is off the top of my head. And she describes the services. And so it gives us a first-person perspective on exactly what the order of service was, how people prayed, the whole nine yards. And if I remember right, it's all of Holy Week. And so she tells us what's going on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, etc. Okay? Third, there are several of those. Third, collections of letters. Okay? We have the letters, or we have some letters, of Antony the Great, written to a variety of people. We have a collection of letters by two saints that are called the two old men. There's one who's the great old man, and then the other one is just called the old man. And their names are Barsanuphius and John. They are monks of Gaza, modern-day Gaza, like the Gaza Strip, okay, that area. The same Gaza, by the way, that Goliath was from. Fourth, formal treatises, okay, which look at the actual theology of monks and monasticism, okay, works by Evagrius, etc. But behind all those, she says, behind all those more kind of formal works are these, the sayings. That is, these are what come first. And it's because of these that the others start to get written. Now, Athanasius writes the life of St. Anthony pretty soon after Anthony's death. Anthony dies in 269. Athanasius writes the life of Anthony, if I remember right, right around 270, 273. Okay? Because Anthony, by 269, already has a huge reputation. Word of mouth has spread. That is, his sayings are already spreading orally. It's only probably 100 years or so afterwards that they start getting written down in this form. Now, Athanasius preserves a lot of sayings. Athanasius personally knew Anthony the Great. We have letters back and forth from them. You know, it's just amazing when you think about it that we have letters that survive from essentially 300 AD, groups of letters. Okay? Then she goes on and talks about the two different kinds of versions of this that I mentioned at the beginning, the alphabetical series and the systematic series, okay, and how they get translated into Latin, et cetera, et cetera. So, 15 minutes to go. The first section is progress in perfection. And I'm not going to talk about all the passages that I have underlined, because we'll run out of time far too quickly. But look at the first one. Notice, Anthony is the first person quoted. Why? He's the greatest. That's why. He's the greatest of the Desert Fathers. All of the other Desert Fathers, Macarius the Great, Evagrius, this guy from the Syrian, etc., they will all look up to Anthony. So, somebody... Notice, the somebody, it doesn't matter who. The who asks him is unimportant. What shall I do in order to please God? And Anthony says, do what I tell you. That is, do this. Well, how can he say, do what I tell you and that'll be pleasing to God? Isn't that a little presumptuous on Anthony's part? Isn't that his way of saying, well, you know, I obviously know the mind of God, therefore.
It's the same thing that Paul's going to do, though, to follow, to do what he's doing because he's trying to do what Christ was doing.
Exactly. See, in this tradition, and this goes all the way up to now, okay? I'm reading a life of a 20th century saint named Silouan the Athenite. His name is Silouan, and he is a monk on Mount Athos. And he had somebody come to him. This is, he died in 1938, something like that. He had somebody come to him and essentially ask him a similar question. And he said, when someone comes and asks me for advice, he says, usually first, I try not to get to say anything. Okay. But if they press, I will give them a short statement, and then I observe and see what they do. And this is why he says he does that. Because if they truly regard me as a quote-unquote holy elder, then they ought to accept any word I say as coming from God. He's not saying every word I say comes from God. He is saying, if they think of me in this way, then they ought to accept any word I say as coming from God. And if they do, they will do it. If they don't, then they're just, you know, interested in games. Or they just want to see what the, you know, the famous elder says. Because by this time, he was already well known. He is not saying at all, I speak the word of God. Okay? He's saying, what's important is what that individual thinks about me. Well, as a man thinketh, so is he. Okay? So, Anthony replies, do what I tell you. And this is what he says. Wherever you go, keep God in mind. You know, what's the injunction given to, who is it, Joshua? Yeah, I think it's Joshua. It's either in Exodus or in Joshua. You know, wherever you go, have God on your mind, have God on your lips, you know, have God on your doorposts, have God on your bed, have God everywhere. Whatever you do, follow the example of Holy Scripture. And wherever you are, stay there and do not move in a hurry. Well, why? Because wherever you are, God can be pleased there. God can be found there. God can be experienced there. So why does he say that? What is almost part and parcel of our human nature? We have a colloquialism or an idiom in American English. Life is always greener on the other side of the fence. That is, it'll always be better where? Over there. So if I just go over there, or I get another job, or I find another spouse, or what? I change something. Okay. He's saying, slow down. Okay. Three things. Keep God in mind. Follow the example of Scripture. And the last one, stay put. Because if you do the first two, when you stay put, everything will work out, okay? I'm not going to talk about those. They talk about don't follow your own will. That same saint that I mentioned, Siloam, says in another passage, referring to that same kind of story, if the person comes and seeks advice, and then they say, but, or, I don't understand, he says he would always shut up. That is, he wouldn't offer any more. Why? Because what does that mean? I don't understand. That's the person saying, I want to take control. That is, I want this saying, but I want to control it by understanding it. He's saying, practice it. Just do it. Just live it. Rather than trying to rationalize it out. Okay? David says somewhere in the Psalms, come, taste, see that the Lord is good. He doesn't say, come, understand. What's the difference between tasting and understanding? Tasting, you're bringing it into yourself. It becomes part of you. Understanding, what are you doing? It's like, you know, a piece of art. You sit aside and you look at it. What does the art never do? never becomes part of you. I mean, this is the problem, I think, with an awful lot of the way literature is taught today. You're taught to look at this poem, look at this story, and do what? Take it apart. Rather than read the poem and let it act like water being poured into a percolation pond. What does the water do? It percolates down. And what does the poem do? If you let the poem speak, it percolates down. It affects you. It becomes part of you. Rather than you're merely looking at it and saying, well, that's a very nice sonnet. I like this rhyme scheme. I like how he turns the volta there. And look at this beautiful imagery. But it never has an impact. Okay? The very last one in that section on progress and perfection. Always look at your own sins. Do not judge another's. Be the servant of all. Do not be self-confident. Control your tongue and appetite. Don't drink wine. If anyone speaks to you on a controversial matter, do not argue with him. If he speaks well, agree. And if he doesn't, then if he says something that's, let's say, not nice about somebody else, I don't know about that. He says to say, don't argue with what he has said, and then your mind will be at peace. Look at this prayer of St. Ephrem. Now, there's another version or another translation of this that says, rather than take from me the spirit of sloth, despair, lust of power in meddling talk or in meddling, says, do not give to me a spirit of sloth, despair, lust of power, and meddling. Okay? The reason that translator does that is because throughout Scripture, what are we told? It's God that sends spirits to people to test them. Okay? So, take from me the spirit of sloth, that is, just not wanting to do anything, despair, lack of hope, lust for power, wanting to be able to control others, and meddling, getting in other people's businesses. But what? Give rather a spirit of chastity, humility, patience, and love to thy servant. Look at the last one. Help me what? To see my own sins and not to judge my brother. Okay. I think, and I could be wrong here, but I think the reason Ephrem does this is he wants this final clause to be the most important one. To not look at what others are doing, but to look internally. Okay? To see what is wrong. Turn to quiet. Number two. Anthony said, he who sits alone and is quiet has escaped from three wars. Hearing, speaking, seeing. But there's still one thing he has to continually fight. His own heart. Hearing, he doesn't hear gossip. He doesn't hear lies. He doesn't hear slander. Speaking, he doesn't speak gossip, lies, or slander. And seeing, why is it that Eve, according to the Genesis account, sins? She sees the tree and what? She sees that it was delightful for the eyes, pleasing to the touch, and would make one wise. Those are all senses. So he's essentially saying, go somewhere, close yourself up, and do what? Start looking inside. Page 11, Matrona, number 14. Okay, this is a woman, obviously. Many solitaries living in the desert have been lost because they lived like people in the world. That is, they go off to the desert, but they don't change. It is better to live in a crowd and want to live a solitary life than to live in solitude and be longing all the time for company. That is, it won't do you a lick of good if you go off in the desert and sit there and think, oh, how I wish I was back in Constantinople, or oh, how I wish I was Athens, or oh, how I wish I was in New York. She says it would be better to be in New York, surrounded by 8 million people, than to be longing for solitude in the desert. Number 9 on page 10. That's the one that we saw in the introduction. In Sadis, a brother went to Moses to ask for advice. And Moses said, sit in your cell, and your cell will teach you everything. Just, that's all you need to know. Okay? Number 16. And we'll stop with this one. Obviously did not get nearly as far as I wanted to. He's talking about the story of these monks and these problems. And we're going to see something very similar to this later on. And we're told there were three friends, serious men, who became monks. One of them chose, actually, no, we won't do that one. We'll wait. Okay, when we come back on next Tuesday, like I said, I'm going to go through probably like two or three of each of these in each of the three sections. If there is a particular one or two or three you want to discuss, we'll start with those, okay? Papers due on Tuesday, remember. No class on Thursday.